morning.
Good morning.
Wow. What a crowd. Amen. Welcome, everyone. The good news scripture for today is a continuation from last week. Last week, we read John chapter 20, verses 1 through 10, which reflects the events leading up to the discovery of the resurrection. Today, we're going to read from John chapter 20, verses 11 through 18, which is a scripture that covers Mary Magdalene beginning to understand what has happened. They didn't understand in advance because they hadn't had scriptures teaching or telling them that this was going to happen. So it was all kind of news to everybody, and it worked out beautifully. So, okay. John chapter 20, starting at verse 11. But Mary stood without at the sepulcher weeping. And as she wept, she stooped down, looked into the sepulcher, and seeth two angels in white, sitting, the one at the head and the other at the feet, where the body of Jesus had lain. And they say unto her, Woman, why weepest thou? She saith unto them, Because they have taken away my Lord, and I know not where they have laid him. And when she had said thus, she turned herself back and saw Jesus standing, and knew not that it was Jesus. Jesus saith unto her, Woman, why weepest thou? Whom seekest thou? She, supposing he to be the gardener, saith unto him, Sir, if thou have borne him hence, tell me where thou hast laid him, and I will take him away. Jesus saith unto her, Mary. She turned herself and saith unto him, Rabboni, which is to say, Master. Jesus saith unto her, Touch me not, for I am not yet ascended to my Father. But go to my brethren and say unto them, I ascend unto my Father and your Father, and to my God and your God. Mary Magdalene came and told the disciples that she had seen the Lord, and that he had spoken these things unto her. Wow. Amen. Greatest event in the history of the universe. The sermon today is titled, A New Again. It's coming from Matthew 28, 1 through 6, and 1 Peter 1, 3 through 4. Have a blessed day today as we celebrate the greatest event in the history of the entire universe.
Amen.
Father, we just thank you for this opportunity today. We thank you, Father, for the meaning of today. We thank you, Father, that you were willing to go up on that tree and that you died for the sins of everyone, each and every one of us, including me. Father, I thank you for the gift of forgiveness that you gave us so freely and so willingly that day, Father. And I thank you for the 3 days later when you came out of that grave and you proved who you were to us. Father, we thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen.
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood. Join us with Jesus as we travel this sod, for I'm part of the family of God. You will notice we say brother and sister around here. It's because we're a family and these folks are so near. When one has a heartache, we all share the tears and rejoice in each victory in this family so dear. I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been one washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood. Join us with Jesus as we travel this odd, for I'm part of the family of God. From the door of an orphanage to the house of the king, no longer an outcast, a new song I sing. From rags to riches, from weak to the strong, I'm not worthy to be here, but praise God, I belong. You grant I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by his blood. Join us with Jesus as we travel this side, for I'm part of the family, of God.
Amen. One, two, ready, go.
I know that my Redeemer liveth and on this earth again will stand. I know eternal life he giveth, that grace and power are in his hand. I know and on this earth again shall stand. I know that life he giveth, that grace and power are in his hand. I know his promise never faileth, the word he speaks, it cannot die. Though cruel death my flesh assailed, yet I shall see him by and by. I know that Jesus liveth, and on this earth again shall stand. I know that life he giveth, that grace and power are in his hand. I know my mansion he prepareth, then where he is, there I may be. A wondrous thought for me he careth, and he at last will come for me. I know that Jesus liveth, and on this earth again will stand. I know that life he giveth, that grace and power are in his hand. I know that Jesus liveth, and on this earth again will stand. I know that life he giveth, that grace and power are in his hand.
Amen and good morning. Good singing.
His son, they called him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future, because he lives. How sweet to hold a newborn baby and feel the pride and joy he gives. But greater still, because he lives, because he lives. future, and life is worth the living just because he lives. And then one day I'll cross that river, I'll fight life's final war with pain. Acclamation and take. shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration, and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sing
Brother Hal and Allison are going to bring our special this morning.
I think so. They were probably talking about me, though. And look good. Look over there. Just look that way.
And we did not plan this.
That didn't take long.
How about if we do that?
That's cool.
Is yours on?
Me too.
All right, Stephen. Exactly how it's supposed to be.
And I'm right here. Can you hear my voice? My life, my love, my Lord, my baby boy.
As they nail me to this tree, just know the Father waits for me.
God, how can this be your will, to have your son and my son killed?
Whatever happens, whatever you see, whatever your eyes tell you has become of me. This is not, it's not the end. I am making all things new again.
Thank you.
Just know the Father waits for me.
God, how can this be your will, to have your son and my son killed?
Whatever happens, whatever you see,
I don't wanna see,
whatever your eyes tell you has become of me,
this is not
it's not the end,
it's not the end.
I am making all things new again. Whatever your eyes tell you has become of me,
this is not
it's not the end,
it's not the end.
I am making all things new again. Who is he that condemneth? It is Christ that died, yea, rather that is risen again, who is even at the right hand of God, who also maketh intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Nay, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Like OIST used to do.
Hello. All right. I think we got it switched. Good morning. It's always good when you sing up a sweat. Let me find my place here and we'll get started. I promise. I think I'm already on my place. Happy Easter. I want to tell you that it's always an honor and a privilege to stand here, but it's even more so today, on this day. Today, all around the world, millions of people gather together to remember what was done for us and to celebrate what was done on you and I's behalf. Jesus was put to death on a cross, but guess what? He defeated death. And he didn't just defeat death for himself. He defeated death for you and for me. For anyone that's willing to accept him as their Savior. The miracle of the empty tomb. Y'all think about this. It gave you and I the ability, the opportunity, if we'll accept it, to have the very same power that raised Jesus from the dead live in us. If that's not a reason to celebrate, I don't know what is. Today I'm going to be reading from Matthew 28. If you have your Bible, you can turn that direction. This is not a scripture that's going to be unfamiliar to you, I'm sure. If you're like me, you've heard this scripture probably in no telling how many Sunday school lessons or how many sermons. You probably read it yourself. But I want you to take time and just because we've heard it so many times, I don't want us to discount what it actually says. I don't want us to take it as ordinary. Dismiss it. This is the basis of all of our faith. Amen. The basis of everything we stand for happened on this day almost 2,000 years ago. I was thinking, and I remember hearing a story. There was a little girl in Sunday school class. Her name was Jenny. And the teacher was teaching about Jesus. And the teacher was telling the students, Jesus is everywhere. Everywhere. There's nowhere that you can go that Jesus is not present. He's by your side. He's holding your hand. He's with you. And little Jenny, she raised her hand. And the teacher said, little Jenny, what? Do you have a question? She said, no, I just wanted to tell you, Jesus is not everywhere. And the teacher said, well, yes, Jenny, he's everywhere. And she said, well, I know somewhere he's not. And the teacher said, well, please tell us, Jenny, where do you think Jesus is not? She said, well, I know for a fact he's not in the grave. The tomb was empty then. The tomb is empty now. If not for that, nothing we do would matter. It's still empty today. And that's the discovery that these two women named Mary are going to make in this scripture. I can imagine as they made their way to the tomb this morning, scripture tells us that it was breaking daylight, it was dawn, it was early in the morning. Their Sabbath had just ended, and they wanted to make their way to the tomb because they wanted to give Jesus a proper burial. They had hastened in the burial because the Sabbath, and they had to get it done. They put him in the tomb. But these people, they loved Jesus. This was their dear friend. This was their teacher, their rabbi. And they were coming back this morning before daylight to make sure that he was given the proper burial that he deserved. Did I offend you already? I'm just playing. My granddaughter's hunting Easter eggs at the church down the road, and she's supposed to be there, so she's going to go there. These people were walking before daylight, and I can imagine their mood. Put yourself in their shoes. What they thought was their Savior, the one that was going to come to free them all from the bondage they were in, they knew what had happened to him 3 days earlier. They knew that he was arrested. They knew that he had been beaten. They knew that he'd been mocked. They knew that he'd been crucified for claiming to be the Son of God. They, along with all the other Jews around, had lost all hope. I bet as they walked that road going to the tomb that morning, not a word was spoken. I bet their hearts were heavy. I bet they were brokenhearted. They had lost all hope, but we're going to read this scripture, and hope's going to come back. Look at Matthew 28. Y'all stand with me, if you will. I'm going to read verses 1 through 6. It says, in the end of the Sabbath, as it began to dawn toward the first day of the week, came Mary Magdalene and the other Mary to see the sepulcher. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for the angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat upon it. His countenance was like lightning and his raiment white as snow. And for fear of him, the keepers did shake and became as dead men. And the angel answered and said unto the women, fear not ye, for I know that ye seek Jesus, which was crucified. Here's our hope, people, right here. Verse 6. He is not here, for he is risen, as he said. Come and see the place where the Lord lay. Thank you, Father, for this day, Lord. Thank you for the opportunity to stand here, Lord, and celebrate that you did what you said you were going to do, Lord, and we place all of our hope and all of our trust in you because we know that you said you're going to come back again, Lord. And that's what we're waiting for in anxious expectation, Lord. Just fill your church with your Holy Spirit this morning. I've already felt you here, Lord. I know you're here. I thank you for that, Lord. Just be with this church service, Lord. And if there need to be a word spoken, Lord, I pray that you just pour it through me the way it needs to be said. In Jesus' name, amen. There was no doubt in anybody's mind that Jesus was dead. Jesus had endured more than most any man could have possibly endured before he passed. The soldiers that stood around the cross, they made absolutely sure that not only was he dead, but they made sure that everyone around looking on knew that he was dead. They ran their swords deep into his side. Then they took him to the tomb, put him in the tomb, and rolled a stone in front of the door that they thought would be impossible for anybody to move. They wanted to put to an end this Jesus and his following. They wanted everybody to know, go home, the show's over. It's done. We killed him, it's over with, go home. They put guards in front of the door to watch it because they didn't want anybody to come in and try to steal the body. But then something amazing happened. Scripture tells us that there was an earthquake, a violent earthquake, and an angel rolled away the stone. It doesn't say it in Matthew. Matthew only mentions one angel, but if you read the account in John, there were two. That's not a discrepancy, as some people would point out. Matthew simply didn't mention the angel that didn't speak. Matthew is talking about the angel that spoke. If you read it in John chapter 20, it says there was an angel sitting where Jesus' head would have been and an angel sitting where Jesus' feet would have been. That's two angels by my math. Now, I went to Carlisle, but I'm pretty sure there were two there. But Matthew only mentioned the one. So there was a violent earthquake and the angel rolled away the stone. It says in Scripture that the guards that were there were so terrified that they were as dead men. In other words, they fainted. They were in shock. And this is where we pick up the story. This is when the two women show up. The first thing the angel told them was, "Do not be afraid." I imagine that was easy for him to say. After what they just saw, can you imagine walking up on that scene and the earth shaking and the stones roll away and there's angels sitting there and they say, "Don't be afraid." Yeah, right. Then he told them the good news that would change everything, that would make everything new again. He told them Jesus Christ was alive. He told them the news that changed their lives, and it also, still to this day, should change our lives. It's the base of our, it's the foundation of everything we believe in. Jesus Christ is alive. The angel said, "He is not here. He is risen," just like he said. These women came to this tomb brokenhearted, broken-spirited. But everything was changed when they learned that Jesus had risen. I can imagine there's probably people here that have come to this church service with the same spirit, the same mood that these women had on the way to the tomb. Maybe you feel brokenhearted, broken-spirited. Life has a way of kicking us around. Maybe you feel like you've lost your purpose. Maybe you feel like you've lost your peace. But most of all, maybe you think you've lost your hope. I want to tell you something. To be in a place where there's no hope is a bad place to be. Amen. But guess what? The discovery that these women made almost 2,000 years ago can change your life just as it changed theirs. It can bring back to newness your hope, your peace, your comfort. Never forget what the angel told them. He said, "He is not here, for he is risen." There was a time in my life when I struggled with that. I struggled with hope. I claimed the Lord as my Savior, as we often always do. I had my fire insurance, you know what I mean? He's my Lord. But I can promise you my heart was far from Him. I was living my worldly, fleshly desires while claiming Him as my Lord because I needed that fire insurance. That's not how it works. I knew who He was. My mom made us go to church. That was the only drug problem we had. I'm sure you've heard this before. The only drug problems we had when I was a kid was that mom drug us to church. You were going to be in church if the church was open. And to be honest with you, I hated it. I did not like going to church. It seemed like it interfered with all the fun stuff. But how thankful am I now that she persisted and that she said, "You come." She made sure that I was in church and I knew who Jesus was. I knew all about Him. I knew what they said He did for me. But I never knew Him. I just knew who he was. You can study this Bible. You can listen to preachers preach. You can listen to teachers teach. You can know exactly who Jesus is, but unless you accept him as your Lord and Savior, it doesn't make any difference. Amen. It would be the equivalent of me going when Bill Gates, is he the richest guy in America still or not? When he dies, if I show up at his will reading and say, I'm here for my inheritance, and they say, well, what do you mean? Who are you? Bill Gates didn't know you, but I knew who he was. There's going to be a lot of people standing in line for their inheritance that Jesus doesn't even know. Just because you know who he is does not mean that you have a relationship with him. That's what you have to have. I remember when I realized I was just going through the motions. I was working a lot. I was at the church a lot. But I was seeing people have experiences. They were experiencing God in a way that I hadn't, in a way that I never had. Yes, I would feel him move occasionally, but I never truly had a fall on my face on the floor experience with God, and I was jealous about it. I remember telling the preacher one time, I don't understand. I'm at church every time the door's open. There's not a job that I haven't done here. I see all these people on their face praising the Lord. I don't feel the urge to do that. Why can't I have an experience like they have? And what he said was very simple and very profound. He said, you're not looking for him. You think you're working for him, but you're not looking for him. When you start to look for him, you'll find him. Scripture says, when you seek me, you will find me. He's not hiding. He's not like Waldo. You don't have to search for him. As soon as you start to look for him, you're going to find him. And once I made my mind up, I'm going to seek him. I'm not just going to work because I thought that that's what it required to get into heaven. A lot of work. That's not the case. You can't work your way there. The only way that we get to heaven is through the blood of Jesus Christ. And it's not enough just to know what he did. You have to accept it. You have to ask him to come into your heart, come into your life, be your Lord. He's very easy to find when you look for him. But he's not going to impose himself on you. Once I decided to look for him, he was very easy to find, and he gave me a renewed perspective. And he made new again my hope. If Jesus can defeat death, and we all know that he did, what is it that he can't do? What is it that we have reservations about in asking him to be the Lord of our lives? If he can defeat death, and no one can argue that, too many accounts of it. People have tried to disprove it. It can't be disproven because it happened. What can he not do? Look at 1 Peter chapter 1. I'm going to read 3 through 4. It says, blessed be the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for who? For you. Peter tells us we have reason to celebrate. God looked down, saw us in our broken state, and poured out his grace on us in the form of his Son, Jesus Christ. He poured out his mercy for each and every one here. Through Jesus Christ, all sin was defeated, and death was conquered once and for all. Peter's saying what we're offered, if you choose to accept it, is a new birth. He can make all things new again. He's saying you can be made new again, free from all your failures, all your sins, all your regrets, all your past mistakes. All the chains that Satan keeps you bound in will fall off. When you think about being born again, you think of a newborn baby. There's not much more precious, more innocent than a newborn baby. Not all of them are pretty. There's some ugly babies. But nobody can argue that they're not innocent. They're as innocent as you can get on this side of heaven when they're born. That is what is offered to us. A new birth to where we can stand before a righteous and just Father and He sees us as if we were newborn babies, that pure and that innocent because of the blood of Jesus Christ. He wants to make you new again. But not only that, Peter says, He'll offer you new life, but He doesn't stop there. Next, he says He wants to give you an inheritance. He wants to make you a child, a full-fledged child of His, in which you will get all that He has in an inheritance. But you will also get it where? Peter says, in heaven. You get to be with the Father. God can change your past, present, and future. But there's one realization that we have to come to. You have to come to the realization that the empty tomb almost 2,000 years ago was for you. It wasn't for me. It wasn't for Tracy. It was for each and every one sitting here. And when you come to the realization that the tomb is empty because Jesus Christ knew my name, it will change you. Boy, I get emotional when I think about what He did. I was reading about a British minister. His name was W.E. Sangster, I believe is his name. He was a well-known British minister. Reached a lot of people, touched a lot of lives, had a big congregation at his church. Born early 1900s. Well, around 1950, he developed a disease. And his disease caused him to lose control of his muscles. His muscles were locking up. He was beginning to lose his voice. And he recognized that, you know, I'm coming to the end of my fight. I'm coming to the end of my race. And so he began to throw himself into prayer, and he threw himself into writing. He said, I want to write as much as the Lord reveals to me as I can while I can still write, while I can still hold a pen. And so he prayed and he wrote and he prayed and he wrote, and I read some of his writings. One of the things that he wrote was, he said, Lord, keep me in the struggle. He said, I may not be a general anymore, but give me a regiment to lead as long as I can. Closer on to the end of his life, actually it was about 3 weeks before he passed, was Easter Sunday. He picked up a pen and he wrote a letter to his daughter with a shaky hand. And this is part of what it said. He said, it is terrible to wake up on Easter morning and have no voice to shout. He had lost his voice completely. It is terrible to wake up on Easter morning and have no voice to shout, He is risen. But it would be still more terrible to have a voice and not want to shout. Amen. I hope that you can join me this morning in shouting, He is risen. We have reason to celebrate. He is risen. If you haven't accepted Him this morning as your Lord and Savior, do it. What are you waiting for? Ask Him to come into your heart and He will. Seek Him and you'll find Him. He's not hiding from you. I was so jealous of all the people that I would see around, and I told the pastor, I'm jealous. And he said, of what? I said, I see these great movements of people and people on their face before God, and I don't feel that. He said, you haven't been seeking him. And he was right. Seek him and you'll find him. He doesn't say he'll smooth out all the roads. He doesn't say that you won't have any more troubles. What he says is, I'll go with you through those. I'll help you. I'll hold you up. When you stumble, I'll pick you back up. I can't imagine anybody that doesn't know the Lord Jesus Christ as their Savior, how they get up in the morning. I'm just being honest. We live in a wicked world. And all of our hope is still on that discovery that those two Marys made almost 2,000 years ago. He is risen just like He said He would. And He is coming back just like He said He will. The tomb's still empty. And it's empty for you. Try Him. Just try Him. Try Him one time. You'll never regret it. Father, I thank You, Lord, for this day. I thank You for the promise that You're coming again, Lord. We thank You that You have never broken a promise, Lord. You gave us a book full of promises, and not one single person can prove that You've ever broken a promise to us. So we lay all our hope in that. We lay all our hope in the fact that You said You're coming back for us, and we're excited, and we're waiting, and we're expecting, because we know it's coming, Lord. We thank You for the opportunity to come here today, Lord. If there be anybody here that doesn't know You, Lord, just draw them to You, Lord, before it's too late. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank y'all so much for coming.
Amen.
I got one question. Is anybody here having fried chicken for lunch? Man, no luck. If you don't have a church home, we'd love to have you back.
Amen. Amen.
If you do have a church home, you're thinking about leaving them, we're probably just as crazy as them. Just stay where you're at. Let's see, who wants to pray us out? Brother A.W., would you mind praying us out?